This page was created to teach black history. Unfortunately, the American educational system was designed to exclude our real historical account. So we are here to dismantle it. It's time to enlighten those of us who have been kept in the dark. I am a black man who didn't know enough about my own history. So I began to dig deeper and do my own research. Black history is American history. So I want people of all races and cultures to join together to learn our history as one. Here, I will share all of my findings. Please like, follow, share, and subscribe to Teaching Black History. The story of Will Brown and the Omaha Race Riot of 1919. In 1910, Omaha had the third largest black population among the new western cities that had become destinations following Reconstruction and during the Great Migration that started in the 1910s. By 1920, the black population more than doubled to over 10,000, second only to Los Angeles with nearly 16,000. The major meatpacking plants hired blacks as strikebreakers in 1917. South Omaha's working class whites showed great hostility toward black strikebreakers. By this time, the ethnic Irish, the largest and earliest group of immigrants, had established their power base in the city. Following several strikes throughout the previous year, two detectives with Omaha Police Department, Morrill Squad, shot and killed an African-American bellhop on September 11th. Local media reports of the alleged rape of a 19-year-old, Angus Lobuck, on September 25th, 1919, triggered the violence associated with Will Brown's lynching. The following day, police arrested 41-year-old Will Brown as a suspect. Lobick identified Brown as her rapist. However, during questioning, Brown stated that Lobick did not make positive identification, which Lobick later refuted. There was an unsuccessful attempt to lynch Brown on the day of his arrest. At about 2 p.m. on Sunday, September 28, 1919, a large group of white youths gathered near the Bancroft School in the South Omaha and began a march to the Douglas County Courthouse, where Brown was being held. The march was intercepted by John T. Dunn, chief of the Omaha Detective Bureau. Dunn attempted to disperse the crowd, but they ignored his warning and marched on. 30 police officers were guarding the courthouse when the marchers arrived. By 4 p.m., the crowd had grown much larger. Members of the crowd bantered with the officers until the police were convinced that the crowd posed no serious threat. A report to that effect was made to the Central Police Station, and the captain in charge sent 50 reserve officers home for the day. By 5 p.m., a mob between 5,000 and 15,000 people had crowded into the street on the south side of the Douglas County Courthouse. They began to assault the police officers, pushing one through a pane of glass and a door and attacking two others who had wielded clubs at the mob. At 5:15, officers deployed fire hoses to dispel the crowd, but they responded with a shower of bricks and sticks. Nearly every window on the south side of the courthouse was broken. The crowd stormed the lower doors of the courthouse, and the police inside discharged their weapons down an elevator shaft in an attempt to frighten them but this further incited the mob. They again rushed the police, who were standing guard outside the building, broke their lines, and entered the courthouse through a broken basement door. It was at this moment that Marshal Eberstein, chief of police, arrived. Chief Eberstein tried to tell the mob that its mission would best be served by letting justice take its course. The crowd refused to listen. By 6 p.m., throngs swarmed about the courthouse on all sides. The crowd whistled revolvers, badges, and caps from policemen. They chased and beat every African American who ventured into the vicinity. White civilians who attempted to rescue black civilians were subject to physical abuse. The police had lost control of the crowd. By 7 p.m., most of the police had withdrawn to the interior of the courthouse. There, they joined forces with Michael Clark, sheriff of Douglas County, who had summoned his deputies to the building with the hope of preventing the capture of Brown. The policemen and sheriffs formed their line of last resistance on the fourth floor of the courthouse. The police were not successful in their efforts. Before 8 p.m., they discovered that the crowd had set the courthouse building on fire. Its leaders had tapped a nearby gasoline filling station and saturated the lower floors with the flammable liquid. Shots were fired as the mob pillaged hardware stores in the business district and entered pawn shops seeking firearms. Police records showed that more than 1,000 revolvers and shotguns were stolen that night. The mob shot at any policeman. 7 officers received gunshot wounds, although none of the wounds were serious. Louis Young, 16 years old, was fatally shot in the stomach while leading a gang up to the fourth floor of the building. Witnesses said the youth was the most intrepid of the mob's leaders. Pandemonium reigned outside the building at 17th and Douglas Streets, one block from the courthouse. James Heichel, a 34-year-old businessman, was shot and killed. The mob continued to strike the courthouse with bullets and rocks, and many civilians were caught in the midst of the mayhem. Spectators were shot while women were thrown to the ground and trampled. Blacks were dragged from streetcars and beaten. Many members of the mob even inflicted minor wounds upon themselves. About 11 o'clock, when the frenzy was at its height, Mayor Edward Smith came out of the east door of the courthouse into 17th Street. He had been in the burning building for hours. As he emerged from the doorway, a shot rang out. "He shot me. Mayor Smith shot me," a young man in the uniform of the United States soldier yelled. The crowd surged toward the mayor. He fought them. One man hit the mayor on the head with a baseball bat. Another slipped the noose of a rope around his neck. The crowd started to drag him away. "If you must hang somebody, then let it be me," the mayor said. The mob dragged the mayor into Harney Street. A woman reached out and tore the noose from his neck. Men in the mob replaced it. Civilians wrestled the mayor from his captors and placed him in a police automobile. The thrower overturned the car and grabbed him again. Once more, the rope encircled the mayor's neck. He was carried to the 16th in Harney Streets. There he was hanged from the metal arm of a traffic signal tower. Smith was suspended in the air when State Agent Ben Bandom drove a high-powered automobile into the throw right to the base of the signal tower. In the car with Danmo were City Detectives Al Anderson, Charles Denson, and Lloyd Tolan. They grasped the mirror and Russell Norgard untied the noose. The detectives brought the mirror to Ford Hospital. There he lingered between life and death for several hours, finally recovering. They shall not get him. Mob rule will not prevail in Omaha, the mayor kept muttering. Policemen were trapped in the building I could possibly burn to death. These slips of paper were thrown from the fourth floor on the west side of the building. On one piece was scribbled, "The judge says he will give up Negro Brown. He is in a dungeon. There are 100 white prisoners on the roof. Save them. Come to the fourth floor of the building, and we will hand the Negro over to you." The mob in the street cheered at the last message. Boys and young men placed firemen's ladders against the building. They mounted to the second story. One man had a heavy coiled rope on his neck, and another carried a shotgun. 2 or 3 minutes after unidentified men had climbed to the fourth floor, Will Brown had been captured. A few minutes later, his lifeless body was hanging from a telephone post at 18th and Harney Street. Hundreds of revolvers and shotguns were fired at the corpse as it dangled in midair. Then the rope was cut. Brown's body was tied to the rear end of an automobile. It was dragged through the streets to 17th and Dodge Streets, 4 blocks away. The oil from red lanterns used as danger signals for street repairs was poured on the corpse. It was burned. Members of the mob hauled the charred remains through the business district for several hours. Sheriff Clark said that black prisoners hurled Brown into the hands of the mob as his leaders approached the stairway leading to the county jail. Clark also reported that Brown moaned, "I am innocent. I never did it. My God, I am innocent," as he was surrendered to the mob. The lawlessness continued for several hours after Brown had been lynched. Both the police patrol and emergency automobiles were burned. The riot lasted until 3 a.m. on the morning of September 29th. At that hour, federal troops under command of Colonel John E. Morris of the 20th Infantry arrived from Fort Omaha and Fort Crook. Troops manning machine guns were placed in the heart of Omaha's business district in North Omaha, the center of the black community, to protect civilians there, and in South Omaha to prevent more mobs from forming. Peace was enforced by 1,600 soldiers. On October 1st, 1919, Brown was laid to rest in Omaha's Potter's Field. The interment log listed only one word next to his name: lynched.